All right, well, we'd like to try to get an understanding of how powerful one of these perceptron units are. So what is it that they actually do? So they return, in this case, either 0 or 1 as a function of a bunch of inputs. So let's just, for simplicity of visualization, let's just imagine that we've got two inputs, x1 and x2. So, Charles, mm-hmm. how could we represent the region in this input space that is going to get an output of 0 versus the region that's going to get an output of 1?
What are the weights?
Right. So indeed, the weights matter. So let's give some concrete values to these weights. And let's just say, just making these up, that weight 1 is 1/2, weight 2 is 1/2, and our threshold theta is 3/4. So now what we want to do is, again, break up this space into where is it going to return 1 and where is it going to return 0.
Okay. So I think I know how to figure this out. So there's kind of there are two sort of extreme examples. So let's take a case where X1 is 0.
X1 is 0. Okay, good. So that's this y-axis. Uh-huh.
Right. So if X1 is 0, what value would X2 have to be in order to break a threshold of 3/4? Well, the weight on X2 is 1/2. Mm-hmm. So then the value of X2 would have to be twice as much as the threshold, which in this case is 1.5.
All right. So we're trying to figure out where is it the case. If X1 is 0, where does X2 need to be so that we're exactly at the threshold? So that's going to be
right.
The X2 times the weight, which is 1/2, has to exactly equal the threshold, which is 3/4. So if we just solve that out, we get X2 equals 3/2. So, okay, so that's this point here. That's going to be a dividing line. So anywhere above here, what is it going to return?
It will return, it'll break the threshold, and so it will return a 1.
So these are all going to be 1s. And then below this, these are all going to be 0s.
Right.
All right. Well, now we have a very, very skinny version of the picture. Well, what else can we do?
Well, we can do the same thing that we just did, except swap x2 and x1 because they have the same weight. So we could set x2 equal to 0 and figure out what value x1 has to be.
Good. And that seems like it would be exactly the same algebra. And so we get x1 is 3/2. Gives us at the 1.5 point. Above here are going to be 1s. Below here are going to be 0s. Okay, so now we've got two very narrow windows. But what we notice is that the relationships are all linear here. So this solving this linear inequality gives us a picture like this. So this perceptron computes a kind of half plane, right? So the half the plane that's above this line, the half plane that's above this line is getting us the 1 answers, and below that line is giving us the 0 answers.
So Michael, can we generalize from this? So you're telling me then that because of the linear relationship drawn out by a perceptron, that perceptrons are always going to compute lines.
They're always going to compute, yeah, these half planes, right? So there's a dividing line where you're equal to the threshold, and that's always going to be a linear function. And then it's going to be, you know, to the right of it or the left of it or the above it or below it, but it's always going to be halvesies at that point.
Okay, so a perceptron's a linear function, and it computes hyperplanes.
Yeah, which maybe in some sense doesn't seem that interesting, but it turns out we're already in a position to compute something fascinating. So let's do a quiz.